welcome to Face to Face on Victoria Indie TV. I'm your host, Paul Stein. Today, we've got Walt McGuinness here. He's the president of StopSmartMeters.ca. They're a group advocating for the referendum on stopping smart meters and the implementation within BC. Hello, Walt. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Paul.
How are you doing today?
Very good, thank you.
Good. So we've got some information today about the recent opt-out clause that are coming in to a lot of people that are opposing the smart meters. But for the benefit of our viewer, maybe we can go ahead and introduce why some people in BC are opposing the smart meters. So what's the information that's been going on?
Well, firstly, the numbers that Hydro is saying, saying around 60,000 people have not allowed a smart meter to be installed. We have reason to believe that it's at least twice that amount. And there may be maybe even higher, maybe up to 150,000 people will not have a smart meter who will be forced, or the Hydro is going to try to force to pay these extra fees. So that's looking, you're looking at maybe up to $75 million a year charged these people for not accepting a smart meter. And if you do the math on that, you realize it's just a cash cow for them. They found a new chain of revenue and a new way to penalize the public for not allowing it, what's deemed to be by many experts as a carcinogenic type agent into their homes, being emitted from the smart meters. So basically, that's what stemmed me and others to join together in groups and try to get the government to come to their senses, basically.
So this smart meter was implemented roughly about a year, year and a half ago, 2 years maybe?
Well, it's a worldwide smart metering program. It's all being implemented all around the world at one time. In British Columbia, the discussion started 4 or 5 years ago. The plans are probably in the works for a decade, and they started installing them with haste last year. So most of the meters went in last year, and some of the meters are now activated and up and running.
Wow, that's interesting. And I guess some of the concerns that a lot of people had right off the get-go was privacy issues, health issues, the security of the information that's collected.
That's right.
And from your standpoint and from a lot of people's, it's the democracy that was neglected within. We had no say in it. It was just implemented. It's like, here's your smart meter. Thanks a lot. They did it in stealth. They'd come to your house when you're not home. And they'd make it quick and in and out. And So give us a little bit more of the background about these issues such as health, privacy, and the security of the information and the democracy that was neglected.
Well, and all these topics are really quite extensive to be explored. I mean, the overriding umbrella issue is a lack of democracy. That's what spurred on the initiative that to vote on the HST, which eventually got rid of the HST out of the province of British Columbia, was a lack of fair process. Now, underpinning that concern of lack of process is these other issues of what these meters can actually do, what they can actually monitor in the home, how that information is used after it's gathered and who has access to that information. So the security and privacy issues there are very serious, and many experts have spoken out against it. And when it comes to the health effects, most of the public just isn't aware of the potential negative health effects associated with this type of radiation. And there's other international experts and agencies that are warning that this type of energy is carcinogenic and a very, very serious health effect that seemingly is being ignored by the government. So we have these issues all intermingling to create a lot of public unease and a lot of dissatisfaction, a lot of people refusing to have the meters placed on their homes. So, you know, what brought us together in our group, StopSmartMeters.ca, is we said, okay, these are very, very credible issues and very, very serious concerns about how the process works in British Columbia. And we think we should implement the Recall Initiative Act one more time. And see if we can get the public to have a say on whether or not they want to have these meters.
And what's been the response to that?
It's very, very, very positive. You know, we have, you know, overwhelming responses to us on our website and our blogs and the sign-ups. And we have a lot of people donating to our cause. And we have a lot of very, very dedicated people that are willing to work on the initiative if we begin the process of the petition. So we're feeling quite heartened that there's going to be a groundswell of energy after the public start to catch on to the unfairness of this whole program.
That's interesting. For me, a big thing about the smart meters that I've done some research on is the health effects.
Yeah.
How many surveys or how many reports have been done that show the negative effects versus the positive effects of smart meters?
Well, you have to go back. You know, a lot of research has been done way back in the 30s, 1930s and on, about microwaves, because there was a lot of concern about the effect of radar and this type of technology on military personnel. And from way back in those days, they decided to protect their workers from a certain level of exposure because they could see that there was actually temperature changes in their body and serious effects. There was lots of other biological effects reported well back, we're talking 60, 70 years ago. Mm-hmm. Now, the last 10 or 15 years of the advent of Wi-Fi, cellular telephones, all the wireless age is upon us. And so there's been numerous studies on populations that have this type of technology and all showing some type or other of negative health effects. There's basically no evidence of safety, credible evidence of safety based upon your general assumptions of what's a non-biased scientific study, on just basic common sense. There's just simply has been no research to show that the microwave radiation being emitted from your smart meter, and by the way, by your appliances.
That's right.
And by the grid in the environment is not harmful. So the authorities and BC Hydro have a huge problem on their hands, is that they do not have any evidence for safety. And that's what we're saying. Bring this evidence to us. We'd love to look at it. We really wish the technology was safe, but all the evidence showing otherwise.
Because it's relatively new, this technology, and they haven't really tested it yet on a scientific level.
Yeah.
And I've seen, on a little segue, I've seen some information online, and I've done some research showing that other things such as cell phones, women that wear cell phones within their breasts, there's a huge amount of breast cancer that's happening exactly where they put their cell phones. And in fact, my iPhone, reading the fine print within the million page instruction manual, says do not put it to your head. Keep it a couple millimeters away from your head. So I think there's some information that's not being told to us about these health effects. And I think this could be one of the reasons why people are questioning it and saying, no, I don't want this on my house.
That's right. I mean, we're almost being penalized for being aware of a health issue. So all the finest and best of British Columbia, the people that are doing their research, really looking at the issues, and really know that there's genuine health concerns, are being penalized for doing so. And all the rest who are oblivious of the issue, basically, and thankfully for shows like this, who are very, very important programs to get to give information to the public. Now, to think about this, to question what I'm saying, to challenge what I'm saying. Go online, look at some research, make inquiries. You know, you have to work a little bit at this. And I always tell the people in the public, don't accept everything as just one way or the other. When often you'll see quotes from Hydro or from the government that become fact. They are no longer in quotation marks in the papers. They just say Hydro meters transmit 5 minutes a day, period, which is not true.
Yeah.
The public should challenge that statement and say, okay, where did that come from? What does it really mean? We know that it's not true because those meters pulse between 14,000 times and 190,000 times a day. That's a much different scenario. So the public has to get engaged. And I think the biggest problem with this issue and many others is that we don't have time. We're busy trying to survive, raise our kids, and do all those other things you have to do in society. And we just don't have enough reserves to do that work that's necessary to really challenge these powers that be.
That's right. And I think, but there's so many challenges in today's society. And I think it's true that only the human being can only handle so many problems at once. And since smart meters is the least of your concerns, there's no worry there. But so we're seeing a lot of privacy issues. We're seeing a lot of health issues, security of the information, where that goes, sold to corporations so they can better make products. And the democracy issue, as you said, it just wasn't told to us properly. I think that's a huge thing. So I see two groups, the groups that don't know anything, and they read the paper and they take the word of the politicians, and then those that are doing a little bit of research and coming out and saying, wait a minute, I want to stop this.
Yeah, and you know, you rely on your intuition. If something doesn't feel right, there's usually a reason for that. You know, we have so many sources of information coming at us right now. You really have a hard time measuring the credibility where it's coming from. Well, I remember years ago, I was at the University of Victoria and Noam Chomsky came. Mm-hmm. And we were all excited about having Chomsky there. And he had a little soiree after his talk. And somebody said, oh, Dr. Chomsky, like, what can we do? How can we get anything done? And whatever we try, we just can't get any attractions. And he says, oh, you have to be a fanatic. And I really looked at him and go, what? He says, yeah. He said, the other side are fanatical. They don't sleep. They spend millions of dollars to push their agenda. They have a tremendous amount of pressure and influence. And the only way to counteract that is you have to become an expert in what you're talking about. You may not be able to, you may not have a PhD, but still you've spent a lot of time researching. You're sound in your information, and that's the only way you can counteract their barrage of misinformation is coming back with the facts. Mm-hmm. And it's a wonderful thing to do. I find it's a kind of an empowering thing to do is when you take on that yourself, because then you feel like, okay, I can now make some change because I have that information now. And I'm not relying on these mainstream sources. And if you get enough people fanatical, then, it usually becomes a small group that has a lot of influence and pushes hard, and you can get some things to change.
Yeah, and what's that saying? Never underestimate a small group can change the world, right?
Yeah.
And it's funny how when the scales are tipped, what is the way to bring balance? There's only two ways, and that is to push underneath, which is an unbalanced way of doing it, or to be on that side to bring the balance back to scale, right?
Yeah, Leonard Cohen has a wonderful song. And one line in the song is something like, there's a crack in every suit of armor, and that's how the light gets in.
Yes.
Every facade you see, this massive brick wall of just seems like impenetrable bureaucracy and inertia, that there's always a crack in that mortar. And our job is to look, find the crack, because the truth always wants to come out. The truth has its own energy. And I think often we'll go and bite our heads against this huge bureaucracy when we should be looking for that little ray of light.
That's right.
And we should be working there and being wise enough to know that change doesn't happen overnight necessarily. Most times it doesn't. It happens after years of careful work. And I see wonderful work being done by a whole lot of nonprofit agencies. And I'm just so impressed by their professionalism and their dedication. Nobody's being paid.
Yeah.
It's
because it's out of their heart. They're doing
it's
it because they're passionate
heart.
About
and,
it.
Right? And when you're doing that and looking for that ray of light, looking for fellow travelers, you will have support around you, and you have a community around you. You don't feel as isolated, and you feel empowered, and that's the way to make things happen. When you get enough empowered people with thinking with their own heads, challenging all the information, then changes will literally occur.
Yeah, and I think that's predominantly the communication tool of the internet that's helped us out big time. So basically, there's been a lot of people that are up in arms about this smart meter phenomenon that's happening around the world, especially here in BC, and those people have put up notices, they've blocked off their smart meter, they've done everything they can to get that. And BC Hydro has been pressuring them, sending them scare tactics, notices, and they're holding their ground. And so what we've now come to, the new development, is this opt-out clause that BC Hydro has given us. Now, would you like to talk to us a little bit about what this new opt-out clause is? What we call the extortion fee of $35. Would you like to explain to our viewer a little bit more about that?
Well, I mean, this has been a new policy that the Liberal government has developed to try to get these last few thousand refuseniks to sign up and to get these meters. So they I'm sure they hatched this plan with every public relations firm they have going for them, because it just has PR written all over it.
Of course.
You know, and so they came up with these so-called three options. Of course, option number one is just to take a smart meter and everything is good. So that's a great option. Number two is they'll give you a digital meter, that it's a smart meter, but with the transmitters, the microwave transmitters turned off. And you can pay a fee, I think it's $20 a month or something, and have your transmitters turned off. So you're not irradiated right away, but those transmitters can be turned on at any time by Hydro with a click of a keyboard anywhere in the world. So there's not a lot of security that those transmitters are going to stay off. And by the way, if you move, your meter automatically becomes automatically smart metered. Now, option number three is if you keep your old analog meter, the very trusty old Volvo of the electrical industry, the old analog meter, nothing ever happened to it. Just turns. I've been an electrician since 1973, never had to replace one, never heard of replacing one.
Didn't burn down houses?
Didn't burn down houses. They're just simply one of those fantastic types of technology. They only consume energy when you're consuming energy. They, you know, the meter spins. So the smart meters are consuming energy 24/7, by the way.
Yes.
So, you know, there's energy consumption just to have these things plugged in. So you have, if you decide to stay with this option, which is the best option as we have so far, they'll let you have that for $35 a month. And but they say when your meter gets old and unreliable in quotation marks, they can put a digital meter in with the transmitters off. But again, if you move or if other things, eventualities occur, there's a few clicks on the keyboard and you're smart metered. So basically, all these so-called options aren't really options.
They're facades. They're just deception.
It really is. We're calling that the Trojan horse approach. You know, make it look like it's a gift, make it look like there's a compromise. But when you really study the fine print, everybody gets smart metered. And that is it. Nobody can go back on the issue, by the way. People that were tricked into getting smart meters, which is hundreds of thousands of people were tricked, they're now becoming aware. Well, guess what? No, you can only keep your smart meter. You can have no options. So look at the fairness in that.
Yeah, it's not fair.
None of this is fair. And that's what's generating the dissension in the public. And this is what's generating the interest in having a referendum on the topic, because people are now just getting these bills and they're realizing this just was not fair. Other jurisdictions like Ontario, who went ahead of us, just as soon as it happened, they got it installed. The premier was warning other provinces not to do it. It was costing two or three times more than they had planned. There's no energy savings. By the way, there is no energy savings. So try to figure out what the raison d'être is here, because you actually are consuming more energy because the smart meters are consuming energy all the time.
Yeah, in fact, I read a couple blogs online, and once they enrolled the smart meter technology in Ontario, prices actually skyrocketed.
Oh, exactly.
And in fact, I've talked to numerous colleagues of mine and friends, and even in the paper, I've noticed that they say, be prepared, hydro could go up even 50%. So for me, that's not smart, that's stupid. It's not a very ethical way of calling this product as a smart technology, when in fact there's a lot of negatives that are to it.
Well, if you accept the technology, given the facts of what this does, it would be stupid to do it. But you know, the clever marketers of the world said, you know, call it what it isn't. If it's harmful, if it's not a good idea because it's going to cost more money and everything like that, let's just call it smart. Most people see smart meter and they're intimidated, like, oh, it's smart, and I guess I'm stupid.
Yes.
The psychology is I'm stupid not to accept it. So it's your Orwellian use of language.
And it's guised into the green philosophy as well. It's greening your electricity. It's greening your home. And by all these products that'll green your home, when in reality, it's not greening anything.
Not at all.
Except the pockets of the politicians and the people that are implementing this stuff.
Not at all. You know, compact fluorescent lights is a good case in point where prominent greens were promoting this and saying it's such a great idea. If you looked at the evidence, it's exactly the opposite. Compact fluorescent lights did not save energy. They're very damaging to the environment. They emit electromagnetic radiation, which is a huge issue. And there's a whole issue around what you do with a toxic product once it's into its life. and there was nothing that they were really doing. They were saying they were recycling these bulbs. I looked into that. It was just atrocious what they called recycling. And I phoned Industry Canada on that issue, and they said, oh, don't worry, most of the mercury is gone from the bulbs before you throw them away. The mercury is gone into your home, gassed off into your carpets, into your kids' toys. Mercury, which is bioaccumulative and very, very damaging. But the thing is, that was a green product promoted by prominent greens, including David Suzuki and company, who happened to get millions of dollars of funding from the electrical industry. I don't know if there's a relationship or not, Paul, but you make your own decision.
That's right.
But we're into that era where this use of sophistry is everywhere, where we turn to, like to the Green Party or to other Greens, and thinking, okay, they're going to help us out here. Don't look for help there right now. There's a lot of education has to occur in the Green Party still. And the NDP and John Horgan and the energy critic, the NDP are full on in support of the smart metering program. We're going to go full on with the program had they become the government. With very few concerns whatsoever, other than going to the Utilities Commission about rates. We have John Horgan and others criticizing the Liberals right now for all these things when, in fact, they were not going to do anything any different. So we don't have any support there either.
So is there any politicians that are against or that are for the people with the choice of making a voluntarily opt-in or having some kind of dialogue, proper dialogue, rather than just forcing it? Is there any politicians that are with the people?
Yes, there is. And Elizabeth May has said some positive things about process. We don't agree entirely with some of her solutions, but the Greens have recognized the health issues federally and provincially. The Greens backed away from that position before the election. For unknown reasons, there's no scientific reason to do that. But the federal Greens have a much more, a more scientific view of it. There are federal NDPers, and I wish I had their names, but there are several very, very good NDPers that are elected federally, that participated in hearings in Ottawa, that are very concerned, as well as the sprinkling in the other parties. Mm-hmm. But they, giving the party structure and the party whipping of voting, and we know all that whole story, that they have no voice whatsoever. If they express their concerns a little too much, they're out of caucus, they're not ever a candidate for a position in the cabinet. So they're all very afraid to really step out and to make bold statements. But we do have support in the background, and we're working very hard to bolster that. And again, it's that little light shining through the crack that we're working on here, hoping someday that we'll be able to really bust a big hole in that wall.
So it seems as if there are a few advocates for it,
yes,
but the majority of politicians are kind of pro smart meters, pro industry.
Yeah.
Actually, Minister Bill Bennett said, quote, "No, we're not going backwards with this program. We still have the goal, and we intend to achieve that goal of getting everyone on smart meters." So it seems like there's an agenda behind this, that it was probably planned prior to the implementation of it, and there's probably lots, billions of dollars to be made on this whole concept.
Well, exactly. I mean, if you look at the Corex and who owns Corex is an investment firm that have boards of directors, people that are receiving money, like Mayor Frank Leonard is on the board. He gets $30,000 a year for sitting on the board of the investment firm that owned the company that installed the meters. And when a vote came to Sand Eats Council on whether to support the idea of a moratorium on the program, it was very hard to pry Frank Leonard out of his chair. And it was brought up by a member of the public that they didn't think he should be voting. He was very willing and ready to vote had that person not brought that up. And I wasn't at the meeting, but eventually he did, I think he called, recuse himself from the vote. But the tentacles reach so far and wide, especially the Liberal, provincial Liberal Party tentacles. And they, elements of the most reactionary sort of political forces in the province, and they are part and parcel for the most part with a lot of the corporate entities that they set on the boards of directors of these corporations. their interests are with these corporations, and the public doesn't really know.
It's that revolving back door that everybody, that nobody knows about unless you do your research and you realize what it's all about.
Yeah, it's really quite surprising sometimes who you find shows up as like on a board of directors. You know, $30,000 a year, that's not chump change.
I think that's more than your average household income.
Yeah, sometimes. You know? So, I mean... And people don't really look, think carefully about that really means, about what it means on the ground. Is very hard to make change.
Yes.
Because these agendas are in the background that we're not aware of, and the affiliations are there and we're unaware of. And it goes right across all party lines. Mm-hmm. That's the sad part of it, is that there seems to be this other agenda happening that's the subtext to all discussions that we are never privy to. That we just seemed, the public never really gets informed about.
Well, so basically what we're talking about here is smart meters, how it was enrolled, and people really didn't like it. So they kind of stood their ground, they defended their rights, they exercised their rights, and then BC Hydro came up with this opt-out extortion plan, which you just mentioned, the three things that you could do, and now that's the latest where we're at here. Now we have some politicians that are predominantly for it, some that are speaking against it, but there's a lot of money to be made. One of the things I like to talk about is solutions, because the viewers at home need solutions, they need ideas on how they can help out, because as you said, you know, one ant... It can't carry a watermelon, but a lot of ants can, and you can do it very effectively. So what are some solutions that you think of that we can tell the viewers on behalf of smart meters, what they can do actively to reinforce the idea that they're not safe and we should have a referendum for them?
Well, that's the main reason that I'm involved right now, and my main thrust is looking for a referendum on the issue. If you go to stopsmartmeters.ca, that's the name of our group, and that's our website, you'll find out all about that process. And we have lots of great information on the website, and it's a good place to kick off your research on the issue. Now, there's a class action lawsuit underway in British Columbia. The group that's sponsoring that is called the Coalition to Stop Smart Meters. Their website's slightly different. It's stopsmartmeters.bc.ca.
Yeah.
Is it .bc.ca?
I think it is .bc.ca.
And you can go to that site and find out all the information around that class action lawsuit. There's another issue being explored, is the human rights issues, which is a very solid case. That people who have real diagnosed sensitivities to electromagnetic radiation, which that cohort is growing every day, have a right not to be exposed. And they've there's a group called the Citizens for Safe Technology.
That's right.
Citizensforsafetechnology.org. If you go there, you'll find out all about that class action lawsuit and how it's progressing. So there's a lot of fronts here, all working for the same goal.
Those are great ideas. And another, I think, a solution is to talk to people about it. Talk to your community. If your neighbor is there with a sign on his smart meter, ask him why. Get into dialogue with people. I think communication is the key to every relationship.
Really, it is.
So
really, it certainly is. I mean, that is so important. Don't be shy. These issues are there. You got concerns. You may not be right up on every aspect of a very complex scientific issue, but if you have a few of the basic concepts down, that you know this is a carcinogenic agent and you know it hasn't been decided on democratically, these are like big enough issues to get engaged, just to ask for a fair process.
Well, thanks so much, Walt. I'm Paul Stein. You've been watching Face to Face on Victoria Indie TV. We'll see you next time.